Normally today you would have a carol service, wouldn't you? You would have a carol service when you would sing carols and you would hear readings. You're going to do it anyway. The singing is going to come from you, obviously led by the videos. The readings, unfortunately, we can't have people trooping up and down. So I'll do the readings for you. And I will speak in between the readings. And God willing, we will get through this. Managed to get through it in Ballymoney earlier. So here we go. First thing that we're going to do this morning is to pray. So let's come before the Lord. Father, we come into your presence. We come with thankful hearts, thankful for the many blessings you have bestowed upon us. Thank you for the blessings that you continue to give us every day. And to thank you especially in this Advent season for the amazing gift of your Son, Jesus Christ. And as we come, Lord, we just ask that you will be present with us here, now, and in the future, and that we will know your leading, your guiding, and your prompting, that as we go through this service, our words and our actions, Lord, will be those which will be honoring to you, and it will be an acceptable form of worship before your throne, that we can honor and glorify your name. And we would ask that you move by your Spirit in our midst today. Let us know your presence. Let us know that peace. And let us know your equipping so that we can worship you. And Father, we would also ask that you move by your Spirit and assure us of sins forgiven by faith in your Son. And we would also ask that you receive the offering that's already been given, that you bless it, multiply it, and give us the wisdom to use it in accordance with your will. These things we ask in the name of Jesus, who taught his disciples to pray by saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen. It was in the 8th century BC, and if you're familiar with reading textbooks and other publications now, you'll find out that the BC has become BCE. It's from before Christ to before the common or current era. You see, the Christ has dropped out, and Anno Domini has dropped out and become the current era or the common era. So in the 8th century BC, a prophet by the name of Isaiah wrote about events that would happen in the future from his time. Now, Isaiah didn't know when those events would happen, but listen to what he said would happen. Reading from Isaiah chapter 9, and we'll go from verse 2. God willing, you'll be able to follow along here. The people walking in darkness have seen a great light. On those living in the land of deep darkness, a light has dawned. For to us a child is born, to us a son is given, and the government will be on his shoulders, and he will be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. Of the greatness of his government and peace there will be no end, and he will reign on David's throne and over his kingdom, establishing and upholding it with justice and righteousness from that time on and forever. The zeal of the Lord Almighty will accomplish this. A promise from God that there would be a mighty one who would come, and that he would be coming from the line of David, and he would be among his people. It was over 800 years later from the time of Isaiah. And that was after 400 years in which God did not speak to his people through a written prophet, that God began to move to fulfill the promise that he had made through Isaiah. But before I tell you about it, I'm going to ask you to sing. You can just remain seated, and it's Tell Out My Soul. It was about 4 BC when there was an old priest by the name of Zechariah serving in the temple. And by lot it fell to him to go and offer the incense on the altar of incense. That little altar was in front of the Holy of Holies. And as Zechariah stood there, making the daily offering of incense, God began to move and speak as an angel of the Lord appeared to Zechariah. Luke chapter 1, beginning to read at verse 11. Then the angel of the Lord appeared to him, standing at the right side of the altar of incense. When Zechariah saw him, he was startled and gripped with fear. But the angel said to him, "Do not be afraid, Zechariah. Your prayer has been heard. Your wife Elizabeth will bear you a son, and you are to call him John. He will be a joy and a delight, and many will rejoice because of his birth. For he will be great in the sight of the Lord. He is never to take wine or fermented drink, but he will be filled with the Holy Spirit even before his birth. He will bring back many of the people of Israel to the Lord their God, and he will go before him in the power and spirit of Elijah to turn the hearts of parents to their children and the disobedient to wisdom and righteousness for the sake of the people prepared for the Lord." And I'm going to ask you to sing again. This time it's Angels from the Realms of Glory.
us from the realms of glory. Wing your flight o'er all the earth. Ye who sang creation's story, now proclaim Messiah's birth.
Zechariah's son was not the promised one that the prophet Isaiah had spoken of. He was to become John the Baptist, whose role was to prepare the way for the Messiah. After 6 months of waiting, the angel of the Lord began to move again, this time speaking to a young woman in Galilee. Her name was Mary. And here we read from Luke's Gospel, Luke 1, 28 to 38. The angel went to her and said, "Greetings, you who are highly favored. The Lord is with you." Mary was greatly troubled at his words and wondered what kind of greeting this might be. But the angel said to her, "Do not be afraid, Mary. You have found favor with God. You will conceive and give birth to a son, and you are to call him Jesus. He will be great and will be called the Son of the Most High. The Lord God will give him the throne of his father David, and he will reign over Jacob's descendants forever. His kingdom will never end." "How will this be?" Mary asked the angel, "since I am a virgin." The angel answered, "The Holy Spirit will come on you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. So the Holy One to be born will be called the Son of God. Even Elizabeth, your relative, is going to have a child in her old age. And she who was said to be unable to conceive is in her sixth month. For no word of God will ever fail." "I am the Lord's servant," Mary answered. "May your word be to me, be fulfilled." Then the angel left her. Going to ask you to sing. This time it's "As with Gladness, Men of Old."
Thank you.
We heard in that last reading that Mary was amazed at the angel's words. Yet, she believed them. And she said that she was the Lord's servant. Mary would have known and understood that she would face ridicule and scorn. But she was willing to accept that in the service of the Lord her God. But Mary's willingness to accept the Lord's will for her life also impacted upon the lives of others. It impacted upon the life of the one to whom she was betrothed, Joseph, an honest, upright man. How would he react to the news that Mary was to have a child that he knew was not his? For the answer, we turn to Matthew chapter 1, and we begin to read at verse 18. This is how the birth of Jesus the Messiah came about. His mother Mary was pledged to be married to Joseph, but before they came together, she was found to be pregnant through the Holy Spirit. Because Joseph, her husband, was faithful to the law and yet did not want to expose her to public disgrace, he had in mind to divorce her quietly. But after he had considered this, an angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream and said, "Joseph, son of David, do not be afraid to take Mary home as your wife, because what is conceived in her is from the Holy Spirit. She will give birth to a son, and you are to give him the name Jesus, because he will save his people from their sins." All this took place to fulfill what the Lord had said through the prophet: "The virgin will conceive and give birth to a son, and they will call him Emmanuel," which means God with us. When Joseph woke up, he did what the angel of the Lord had commanded him and took Mary home as his wife. But he did not consummate the marriage until she gave birth to a son, and he gave him the name Jesus. And once more we sing, this time as good Christian men rejoice with heart and soul and voice.
Rejoice with heart and soul and voice, giving ear to what we say. News, news, Jesus Christ is born today. Ox and ass before him bow, and he is in the manger now. Christ is born today, Christ is born today. Good Christian men rejoice with heart and soul and voice. Now ye hear of
It would be fair to say that Joseph was a bit taken aback by the news of Mary's pregnancy. How could she have broken the pledge that was made between them and their families? But yet, he didn't want to expose Mary to public humiliation or even physical harm. He considered breaking the pledge himself, and then he would face the ridicule for for not keeping his marriage promise to Mary. But after the Lord had appeared to him in that dream and confirmed that the child that Mary was carrying had been conceived through the overshadowing of the Holy Spirit, Joseph accepted Mary and took her home as his wife, as he had been commanded by the Lord. And that too would have brought Joseph to the place of suffering some ridicule and scorn from his friends and neighbors, who would no doubt have been thinking, "Well, Joseph, we know that you broke the pledge and you had a relationship with Mary before the appointed time." But he was willing to take that to fulfill God's command to him. But there was another problem. Another 8th century prophet, the prophet Micah, had said that the child to be born would be born in Bethlehem. Let me read this for you. It's from Micah chapter 5, and we'll begin to read at verse 2. "But you, Bethlehem Ephrathah, though you are small among the clans of Judah, out of you will come for me one who will be ruler over Israel, whose origins are from of old, from ancient times." Now, Mary and Joseph lived in Nazareth of Galilee, which was at least 60 miles north of Bethlehem as the crow flies. So how could the Lord have gotten it so wrong that he said the child was to be born in Bethlehem when they lived in Nazareth? Or what was the Lord going to do to ensure they were in Bethlehem at the time of the birth? But before we hear that, let's sing, "O Little Town of Bethlehem."
Thank you.
How did the Lord move? We're accustomed at times to singing, "The Lord moves in a mysterious ways, his wonders to perform." Let's hear how God moved to have Mary and Joseph in Bethlehem. Reading from Luke chapter 2, verses 1 to 7. In those days, Caesar Augustus issued a decree that a census should be taken of the entire Roman world. This was the first census that was taken while Quirinius was governor of Syria. And everyone went to his own town to register. So Joseph also went from the town of Nazareth in Galilee to Judea, to Bethlehem, the town of David, because he belonged to the house and the line of David. He went there to register with Mary, who was pledged to be married to him and was expecting a child. While they were there, the time came for the baby to be born, and she gave birth to her firstborn, a son. She wrapped him in cloths and placed him in a manger because there was no guest room available for them. God did move in a wondrous way. He got the leader, if you like, of the known Gentile world, the Roman Emperor, Caesar Augustus, to issue a decree under the basis that he wanted to know how many people were in the empire that he could tax, or how many he could recruit into his army, or how many potentially would be there to oppose him or to oppose his armies. So a census was to be taken. And because Joseph was descended from the house and the line of David, he had to travel to his ancestral family home, Bethlehem. Now the word of the prophet had not been wrong. God had known the plan that he was going to use to have Mary and Joseph in exactly the right place at the right time to fulfill what he had said over 800 years earlier to his people through the prophet. And the birth of that child, the one who was to be of David's line and would sit and rule on David's throne forever, his birth did not take place in a palace or in an inn, but in a stable. And it was not announced by royal heralds. It was not announced to the king. It was announced by the choirs of heaven to ordinary shepherds as they went about their daily life, as they watched sheep on a hillside. Let's sing again. This time, it's once in royal David's city stood a lowly cattle shed.
Oh,
it was announced to shepherds what was going to happen and what was taking place. We read from Luke chapter 2, beginning at verse 8. And there were shepherds living out in the fields nearby, keeping watch over their flocks at night. An angel of the Lord appeared to them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were terrified. But the angel said to them, "Do not be afraid. I bring you good news that will cause great joy for all people. Today in the town of David, a Savior has been born to you. He is the Messiah, the Lord. This will be a sign to you. You will find the babe wrapped in clothes and lying in a manger." Suddenly, a great company of the heavenly host appeared with the angel, praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest heaven, and on earth peace to those on whom his favor rests." When the angel had left them and gone into heaven, the shepherds said to one another, "Let us go to Bethlehem and see this thing that has happened, which the Lord has told us about." So they hurried off and found Mary and Joseph and the baby, who was lying in a manger. When they had seen him, they spread the word concerning what had been told them about this child. And all who heard it were amazed at what the shepherds said to them. But Mary treasured up all of these things and pondered them in her heart. The shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all the things they had heard and seen, which were just as they had been told. Going to ask you to sing, and it won't surprise you that it's while shepherds watched their flocks by night.
The shepherds watch their flocks by night, all seated on the ground. The angel of the Lord came down, and glory shone around. "Fear not," he said, "for mighty dread had seized the troubled minds. Glad tidings of great joy I bring to you and all mankind. To you in David's town this day is born of David's line, the Savior who the Lord, and this shall be the sign. The heavenly babe you there shall find, to human view displayed, and meanly wrapped in swaddling bands, and in a manger laid. Thus spake the seraph, and forthwith appeared a shining throng of angels praising God, who thus addressed their joyful song: "All glory be to God on high, and to the from him to men begin and never cease."
In 2020 AD, Anno Domini, or CE, the common or current era. That's around 2,000 years after the birth of the Christ child. We're still telling that story of how God moved to send a Redeemer into the world, to send his one and only Son in the form of an infant to become the Savior of all humankind. Jesus, the Son of God, whose birth we'll be celebrating in 5 days' time, still moves to save people today from their sin. But what he needs are humble, open hearts from us to invite him in to our lives. And just as God needed humble, faithful servants like Mary and Joseph all those years ago, he still needs humble and faithful servants today to come and serve, that his will and his word and his message may be proclaimed in our setting. Now, I know this Christmas is going to be greatly altered for many. And we're hearing about bubbles and bubbles being reduced and infection rates going up. And so restrictions are being imposed. But there is one you can invite in who will not take up a place in your bubble and who will not have to leave, but will willingly stay as your guest in your life. And that is Jesus Christ, the one whose birth we've been hearing about. I wonder, have you got room for him in your heart this Christmas time? Does he reside there? Will you invite him in? Because if you do, he will never leave you nor forsake you. So that no matter what's going on in the world around, you know that you can rely and trust on him. Let's take time to come before the Lord in prayer with our prayers of intercession. Let us pray. Father, we come into your presence in an attitude of prayer as we gather here. And we know that your word tells us that when two or three gather together in your name, you are there in the midst. And when we ask in the name of your Son, not only do you hear our prayers, but you answer them. So we come before you in the name of Jesus to ask for your leading, your guiding, and your protection. Father, we ask for your leading and guidance for those who are in public office at this time, not just in our own land and across these islands, but around the globe. We're hearing so much of a pandemic that is encasing and encompassing the whole world. So, Father, we need leaders who are guided by you and who are humble enough to listen to your direction. So, Father, speak in such a way that those in those public offices around this world and here in our own land will hear and will obediently follow your direction. We ask for protection, Lord, for those working in our health care and our health service, whether they be in hospitals, in homes, in residential homes, in nursing homes, and even providing care in the community. As they seek to serve others with their knowledge, with their talents, their gifts, we pray, Lord, that they will be protected from the worst of this pandemic that is spreading, that they may know your strengthening and equipping, as they go through stressful times, may they know peace in their hearts and minds and physical restoration. And Father, for our families and friends and our community, so many things are being disrupted. So many family gatherings not taking place. And so, Father, we pray for family and friends. We pray for the community in which we dwell. We just ask, Lord, that you will move in a mighty way and draw each and every one of us closer to you. And as we head into this season, we know there are those who will be facing this Advent without loved ones. And we pray for all who find themselves in the place of grieving and mourning, that they may be comforted by your presence, that they may know your peace and your direction. And for those who are going through times of illness, we pray that you will move in a mighty way there, that you will bring restoration, you will bring comfort and peace and wholeness. For those who are struggling with regards to wondering what the future holds for them, economically, business terms, employment terms, we pray that you will meet those people at their point of need and give them the guidance and direction they need. And Father, for those who gather with us this morning here, those sitting around us, in front of us, behind us, to our right, to our left, we lift them to you and ask, Lord, that you will meet each one at their point of need. We may not know what all of the needs are, but you do. So we commend one another, Lord, into your care and into your keeping in a moment of stillness. Father, we know that you hear the prayers offered in the name of Jesus. Open our eyes, our hearts, and our minds that we might understand how you're responding to the prayers that we have offered. In the precious name of Jesus, your Son, our Savior, and Lord. Amen. Going to ask you to sing our closing piece. It's not one that you would normally say is a Christmas carol, but I think it's one that reflects what Christ did when he came to earth. And it's the servant king, from heaven you came, helpless babe, entered our world, your glory veiled. From heaven you came. Worship to the servant king. Are we offering our lives in service to him? There is an individual who sends me little text messages most Sunday mornings. Sometimes it's an image, sometimes it's a little video of a song. But I've asked Nigel to put this one up for you, and I'll read it for you just in case it's not big enough for you to read. If we cannot gather in person, Emmanuel, God with us, even if some Christmas traditions have had to go, Emmanuel, God with us, even if we might not get to hug family and friends, Emmanuel, God with us, even if we cannot sing carols beside each other, Emmanuel, God with us, even if Christmas cheer is harder this year, Emmanuel, God with us. He is with us, and he wants to dwell with you and in you. Will you invite him in this Advent season? Let's say the words of the grace together and to each other. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all, now and forevermore. Amen. Amen.